Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Immunity, the Science of Staying Well, the Definitive Guide to Caring for Your Immune System, by Dr. Jenna Macciochi, narrated by Cat Gould. Publisher's Note: This book contains the opinions and ideas of its author. It is intended to provide helpful and informative material on the subjects addressed in the book. It is sold with the understanding that the author and publisher are not engaged in rendering medical, health, or any other kind of personal professional services in the book. The author and publisher specifically disclaim all responsibility for any liability, loss, or risk, personal or otherwise, that is incurred as a consequence, directly or indirectly, of the use and application of any of the contents of this book. A brief note to healthcare professionals. In this book, I have sought to present some of the current and big ideas in my field, fusing them with my own stories, personal anecdotes, and my passion for this subject. My aim was also to convey a sense of wonderment for this silent system and the vast and complex science it encompasses. I am acutely aware that this is not, and could never be, an exhaustive text on the immune system. In my attempt to keep the narrative and scientific ideas as clear as possible for the general reader, I could not cover all the topics I wanted to, or discuss them in the depth they may warrant. And rather than present a complex textbook-level description, I have deliberately chosen to focus on the broader contemporary issues, to bring an awareness to how modern lifestyles and our rapidly changing environment interact with and shape our immunity and, ergo, our health. In my quest to be evidence-based, I have dived into the scientific literature, consulted with colleagues, and reached out to other experts along the way, combining this information with case studies and alternative health literature to give a balanced and holistic overview. In some cases, the only evidence available is weak, or at least not the most rigorous, so I have made efforts to state this where appropriate. Ultimately, any one book can only tell part of a story, and this, I hope, is just part one. Preface. The initial observation that spurred me to write this book was the concerning change in the spectrum of diseases faced by our immune systems today. Sanitation, vaccines, and antibiotics won us the modern era and transformed our health. Germs are no longer considered enemy number one, but the war on our health certainly isn't over. Today's global boom of non-communicable diseases, NCDs, and lifestyle-related conditions is a pandemic that has silently emerged over the last few decades, fueled by a creep in our lifestyles. We have become sedentary, surrounded by food at every turn, with stressful jobs that don't end when we leave the office, and too many reasons tempting us to prioritize screen time over sleep. We might be living longer, but are now far more likely to die from non-communicable diseases like cancer, heart disease, or Alzheimer's than from a contagion, a considerable change from the infectious diseases that challenged our past. We are getting sicker, but infections are not to blame. That's the good news. The bad news, as COVID-19 reminds us, is that infectious diseases haven't vanished. COVID-19 might be caused by a new virus triggering a global pandemic, but it marks the return of a very old, very familiar enemy. Nothing has killed more humans through history than tiny, invisible microbes. As of this writing, May 18, 2020, there are more than 4.6 million confirmed cases of COVID-19 around the world and more than 300,000 deaths, touching every continent save Antarctica. Not to mention the many more probable unconfirmed cases. This was a pandemic, in reality, well before the World Health Organization finally declared it one on March 11, 2020, and most of us didn't see it coming, perhaps a stark reminder to us all. The COVID-19 pandemic has triggered the world to sit up and take notice of germs, a cognitive shift. All topics of conversation that are not around the pandemic seem suddenly trivial. While COVID-19 grabs our attention, tips and tricks for taking care of our guardian protector, the immune system, firmly takes a seat at the conversation table globally. SARS-CoV-2 is painfully demonstrating our vulnerabilities, perhaps because there are many other aspects of our modern life that are contagious too. Obesity, loneliness, and a plethora of negative psychosocial and socioeconomic issues that collectively have been silently eroding our immunity. Disease, infectious or otherwise, can only get a foothold in a population if new cases outnumber recoveries. The global boom in premature morbidity from NCDs shares many similarities with pandemics of infectious diseases. Yet public health professionals have resisted the adoption of this label. Infectious disease and non-communicable disease are not mutually exclusive. NCDs are a leading risk factor for becoming severely ill if you do catch an infection, and the waves of death associated with both infectious pandemics and other seasonal infections are often followed by waves of death due to other causes, notably heart attacks and strokes, indirect consequences of the collateral damage caused by our immunity's inflammatory response. Though we still have much to learn, COVID-19 probably isn't exclusively a respiratory infection. Despite negative health trends like pandemics catching on, somehow it seems to take much longer for human thinking to do the same. Just as previously, and misguided thinking assumed people who caught infectious diseases had only themselves to blame. So we too now place blame on the individual suffering a chronic condition like obesity. If anything, floating in the limbo of lockdown, this pandemic reveals a truth behind our immune system. Infectious diseases and NCDs need to be tackled at the population level. Immunity becomes not only biological, but societal. Both infectious and non-infectious disease carries crippling economic costs overwhelming our healthcare systems, albeit one more slowly and silently than the other, and cannot be easily reversed under the conditions of our 21st century lifestyle, where many of us already feel we are functioning at 20% below our best, even in the absence of a diagnosed health condition. It's a signal that your immunological needs are not being met, a signal we have all been ignoring, and now is the time to listen. None of us have immunity to this virus. This pandemic reminds us that although some may be more vulnerable than others, COVID-19 has caused fatalities among patients under 60 and put hundreds of them in intensive care. There is little hierarchy in our immunity. Our immune system is more complicated than that. If you fall into the not too young, not too old, healthy adult category, there are few clues as to whose immune system will betray them with a dangerous and damaging overreaction to the virus. Unpacking this riddle remains the holy grail of immunology. As I discuss in Chapter 1, our compatibility genes are the prototypical candidates for genetic susceptibility to infectious diseases, and perhaps non-infectious ones too. There are around 25,000 total human genes. We each have a similar set of these genes, but those that vary the most from person to person are our immune system's compatibility genes. This makes the immune system almost as specific to each individual as our fingerprints. Our collective immunological diversity protects us, but we vary individual to individual, and rightly so. This is evolution's way of keeping our species alive. If we all responded to an infection in the same way, we would be dead ducks by now. On the other hand, it teaches us that germs are not an equal opportunity killer. The Spanish flu in 1918 to 1919 targeted healthy young adults. COVID-19 has a predilection for the elderly and those with an already compromised health status. COVID-19 also teaches us that we can prevent infection, but both a hypermodern and practically medieval response is needed. Scientists around the world are using cutting-edge tools and technology to understand the infection, and we are sharing information and collaborating globally far quicker than could have been done before. In the meantime, our only effective response has been to shut down society. It's not that different from what our ancestors might have tried to halt an outbreak of the plague. Today, we may have all gone into sanitation overdrive, but it's a timely reminder that coughs and sneezes cause diseases, and hand washing is the cornerstone of infectious disease prevention that we have all probably been doing wrong, or at least not for long enough. As the world shuts down in an unparalleled response to a disease, we ask ourselves, how long do pandemics usually last? We collectively forgot the worst catastrophe of the 20th century, the so-called Spanish flu, that happened just over 100 years ago, and now it's all anyone can talk about. Disease modellers hunting for clues have a saying, if you've seen one pandemic, you've seen one pandemic. COVID-19 doesn't behave like flu, which doesn't behave like Ebola. Though there are commonalities, the rules are different. The truth is, it can take a long time for the tide to go out, and no one really knows how long. But what of our immunity during lockdown? Life is abnormal. We find ourselves discombobulated, lacking routine, with sleeping patterns all over the place, and struggling to exercise without our usual rhythms and routines in place. We start hunting for a quick fix. Alcohol and junk food feels like an easy way to cheer ourselves up while we Google supplements to boost your immune system. Sometimes the pressing needs of a pandemic create a unique environment and set of needs that don't necessarily align with the key inputs needed for our long-term health. But caring for your immune system is for life, not just for a pandemic. Just as there was a before COVID-19, there will be an after. Non-infectious diseases might have overtaken germs as the leading cause of death worldwide, but this pandemic is a benchmark, a reminder of just how powerful microbes are and just how frail our lifestyles and societal ecosystems have become. Germs really freak people out, even though they are everywhere, and 99% of them won't hurt us. Many infectious viruses were kept at bay in the 20th century by the development of vaccination. However, we don't yet have vaccines against all the viruses, like HIV, for example. And as new ones appear in a supermobile, overpopulated world, the threat of pandemic will probably always lurk over mankind. Pandemic preventive measures have led to excessive use of hand sanitizer, but excessively using alcohol-based hand sanitizers could remove normal bacteria flora that coat the skin. Could this counterintuitively increase your risk for other infections and health issues in the long term? As I explain in Chapter 3, we now know that in our attempt to remove all infectious germs over the last few decades, we seem to have removed too many of the good guys, too. Eroding our own microscopic health allies prevents the normal development of the immune system, ultimately increasing the chance of disorders within this system down the road. When it comes to good germs, bacteria certainly have a better reputation than viruses, as seen in the rise of feel-good marketing for good gut health. Viruses have no such sheen of benevolence. The British biologist Sir Peter Brian Medawar defined viruses as a piece of bad news wrapped in a protein coat. Viruses, from the Latin for poison, are everywhere. Just because you don't have the flu doesn't mean that you aren't teeming with viruses inside and out, a poorly understood community collectively known as the human virome. But what are all these viruses doing if they aren't making you sick? They occupy every square millimetre on the human body's exposed surfaces, with plenty more inside. We are not just fighting a pandemic, we are fighting an infodemic of rumours and misinformation, a tsunami of copy-pasted shared social media posts allegedly written by anonymous experts frequently promote suspect advice or inaccurate information, evolving quicker than the germs themselves into multiple, slightly modified versions and have frequently gone viral on social media platforms. This phenomenon existed even in the pandemics of the past, but social media has zipped information around the globe, amplifying it at an unprecedented speed. Mental health is physical health. As I discuss in Chapter 5, our immune system is a sensing system in constant contact with our brains. Uncertainty breeds fear. With the modern-day rolling media, there is a lot of airtime to fill. The constant barrage of bad news in the media can add to feelings of stress and despair. The media doesn't often put the outbreak into perspective. It's time to condo your news and step away from your screens. Much of what is happening when a pandemic strikes is overwhelming and out of our control. But we as individuals can do so much within our circle of the things we can influence. This brings to mind the phrase by the productivity author, Dr. Stephen Covey. I am not a product of my circumstances, I am a product of my decisions. We need to adapt and create because that is what our biology is designed to do. Trying to preserve some sense of normalcy by creating a rhythm and routine to your days and weeks might feel like it offers as much protection as a rabbit's foot, but it provides a sense of agency, a feeling of being proactive, which is of great psychological and therefore immunological importance. Housebound and bored, there is only so much you can do during lockdown. It is easy to be sedentary, stuck at home glued to our screens. But now more than ever, we shouldn't neglect movement to strengthen our immune systems. Love your lymph and take stretch breaks and movement snacks throughout the day. Every little bit of movement counts, so no matter what it is, just make sure to move, move, move throughout the day. Exercising at home can be simple, and there are options for most ages and abilities. Just don't neglect resistance exercise, especially for those over 30, when our skeletal muscle starts to decline through a process called sarcopenia, a natural part of aging. If you don't use it, you lose it, and that has a big impact on our immunity, as I discuss in Chapter 6. Binging isn't just about Netflix. Stress eating your way through your lockdown provisions can be an easy trap to fall into. As I discuss in Chapter 7, consistently over-consuming calories is bad news for our elegant immune defences. Before you turn to superfoods, aim for mealtime consistency, including plenty of fibre and phytonutrients, and focus on good fats and quality protein. But perhaps most importantly of all, don't neglect flavour. Use commuting time for a little mealtime self-care. Even a perfect response won't end the pandemic, but we all have a role to play. Though we perhaps have never felt more vulnerable individually, it's also true that we've never had a better opportunity to show ourselves and one another what it means to be a member of the human family. With any trauma comes an opportunity for reflection and growth. The sudden jolt to your life might hopefully make you hyper-aware of the aspects of your lifestyle that were not serving you well. Someday in the future, we will be recounting the ways that the 2020 pandemic changed everything. Why not look at the disruption to our everyday lives as an opportunity to change for the better? Take those first shaky small steps that focus on long-game health. Most importantly, don't wax lyrical about how you are going to change everything, then revert to type when it's all over. Chapter 1. How to be well in a modern world. There is no permanent ideal of disease resistance, merely the shifting sands of impermanent obsolescence. Matt Ridley, science writer. Described by the US National Library of Medicine as the most complex system that the body has, our immune system is a vast constellation of cells and molecules spanning every nook and cranny of our bodies. What's immunity, and why should you care? Immunity, from the Latin immunis, meaning exempt, refers to the art and science of the human immune system, the various biological defense systems that keep us well. The immune system is a silent wonder. While we are very aware of our hearts beating and the breaths we take, we are much less aware of our immune system and the many jobs it performs to keep us well. This mighty system protects our health by resisting uninvited infections, maintaining order and balance in our bodies, and healing wounds. It is our foundation to well-being. Immunology, the extraordinarily rich yet complex study of the immune system, has changed the face of modern medicine over the last 30 years. There has never been a more fascinating time to delve into immunology and harness its power to improve your health. And that is what this book will do for you. Based on cutting-edge, evidence-based scientific research, this book takes you on an empowering journey through the latest astonishing discoveries in immunology. You will get to know the immune system inside and out and come to an intimate understanding of how it works. It is not often that one body system touches so many aspects of human biology in both sickness and health. Although it is seemingly esoteric and beyond comprehension at first blush, the immune system is the epitome of versatility and simplicity of purpose. When it comes to maintaining good health, the immune system is our most precious asset. Yet we rarely appreciate our essential defenses until something goes wrong. We thank our immune system when we catch a cold and scramble for vitamin C supplements in the winter months, but what about all the other wonders it works? If it only existed for the first few weeks of chilly weather every year, we'd all be in serious trouble. Most of the time, our immune system is working away in the background and we don't even notice it. Deeply entwined with every aspect of our physical and mental health, it lays the foundations of our health and longevity. Immunity is a sophisticated system with astonishing complexity, but there is a lot that can go wrong, from autoimmune diseases and allergies to mental health problems and metabolic issues, even cancer. We have an obsession with looking healthy and being well, and yet we are sicker and unhappier than ever before. That's because our delicately balanced immunity is easily compromised by our ever-accelerating pace of life, with its relentless stress, pollution, over-consuming, and under-moving. What modern life deems healthy may not actually be so. Today, we're more likely to die from a lifestyle-related disease than any other cause. And many of these would be preventable if we took better care of our health. On our journey through modern immunology, you'll discover why the immune system is your sixth sense, connecting your health to your environment, feelings, and emotions. why some people rarely get sick, what to do if you have a chronic illness, and what it really means to boost your immunity. My endless wonder at this vast and elegant system, integral to our well-being, has been the driving force behind both my career and personal life. From an early age, I was intrigued by the human body, health, and disease. My mum, a trained cook, strongly believed that health was in our own hands and taught me the old-fashioned cooking basics that have become a vital tool in my modern-day mum life toolbox. She was my original purveyor of old wives' tales, yet there was a wealth of untapped wisdom in her words that left me with a lingering curiosity, shaping my path as I embarked on my scientific career. As I've discovered more about the immune system, I've found myself changing how I live in response to what I've learned. I'm driven to question what modern life tells us is healthy, yet makes our immunity go awry. Every day I find myself hunting for clues, researching the evolution of the immune system, and thinking about the traditional ways of life that have shaped our health. Have we thrown the baby out with the bathwater by swapping old ways for new and shiny modern ones? This is a question I keep coming back to, and one that I'll answer in the chapters that follow, while also exploring how we can reclaim our innate knowledge of immunity through traditional rituals supported by science. Keep in mind as you move through the chapters that the immune system is a bit like a wiggly moving octopus. Its undulating nature makes it difficult to cover it in a linear, page-by-page fashion. And one of its slippery charms is that the answer to many questions about it begins with, "It depends," or "It's complicated." Understanding the secrets of how to be well requires a balance between openness to new ideas, no matter how counterintuitive they may seem, and ruthless scrutiny of all concepts, both old and new. Despite its immense power, we often hear calls to boost our immune system through food, exercise, or a well-being practice. Although there remains much to learn about its interconnectedness and intricacies, to function well, the whole system requires balance, not boosting. Read on as I explain what this means for your health. Infection protection. The immune system is all that stands between us and the hordes of microbes, also known as germs, which are microscopic organisms including bacteria, fungi, and viruses too small to be seen by the naked eye, that threaten us constantly. Hippocrates, 460 to 377 BCE, was the first to find a scientific explanation for disease. His was the theory of the four humours, yellow bile, black bile, phlegm, and blood, in the body. The idea that these were in balance in healthy beings, but out of balance in a sick person. Sickness, he claimed, was the result of an excess of one of the humours caused by miasma, poisonous vapours or mist filled with particles from decomposed matter, or miasmata, vapours coming from decomposing organic material, such as waste, manure, or dead bodies. This theory may sound strange to us now, but reflects the limited tools and technologies available at the time. Without a way to see germs, scientists didn't have much to go on. In the mid-20th century, as equipment for poking and probing evolved, germ theory, devised by Louis Pasteur, the father of immunology, and his contemporaries, emerged and soon replaced the four humours in public consciousness. Germ theory is how most of us think of immunity. Germs are bad, and immunity's white blood cells are our guardian protectors. But of course, nothing with health and immunity is ever that simple. Immunity is hardwired to detect and differentiate between what is us, self, and what is foreign, non-self, such as a germ. This makes it easy for our immune system to decide what to attack. Non-self, potentially dangerous germs that need eliminating, normally sparing our own precious tissues. The immune system has had a complicated, you might even say fraught, relationship with germs over the years. For centuries, we have drawn a causal conclusion that microscopic germs cause illness, and for good reasons. Devastating outbreaks, infection epidemics, and perplexing illnesses have all been caused by the veritable smorgasbord of microorganisms that we share this planet with. Over the last decades, our fear of them has been realized, with devastating reports of swine flu, Zika, Ebola, and many others, each outbreak prompting new concerns about infection protection. But from birth to death, we are silently bombarded, minute by minute, with an untold number of potential infectious threats. Whether we get sick or not is decided by the integrity of our immune system. Most of the time, our immunity deals with these germs without us even knowing about it. That's how powerful the system really is. There are no medications that can protect us in our infectious world quite like our immune system. The immune system. A really, really, really brief explainer. Though vastly complicated and mind-bogglingly confusing, as any of my immunology students will tell you, let's try and keep it real simple. The immune system is not, in fact, one thing, and it's not in one place. Rather, the immune system is a whole galaxy of cells known as white blood cells, leukocytes, to give them their scientific name. Immunity also includes lymphatic organs, such as lymph nodes, bone marrow, and spleen, and molecules, cytokines, and their collective array of biological functions. The bone marrow is your immune cell factory where new immune cells are born from stem cells, a blank canvas cell with the capacity to evolve into any one of your numerous immune cell types. Despite their name, white blood cells are not just found in your blood, but in strategic locations all over your body. Every single one of them brings its own particular skill set, featuring an array of receptors and molecules capable of inducing the many different flavors of an immune response. Border control. A good way to start understanding the immune system is to think of it like a castle, a fortress with many layers of defense, all working as a close-knit team. Your body's borders act as the first line of immune defense. Skin and the mucous membranes that line your natural openings, such as your mouth, nose, and digestive tract, are part of your immunity, making and releasing substances that create a hostile environment for invaders or attacking and destroying them directly. These physical barriers are as delicate as they are protective, with inherent vulnerabilities. And over the millennia, just about every germ that wants to get in has evolved ways to help it do so. In response, our immunity, or castle, has devised a sophisticated system, choosing the best and discarding the least useful bits of our elegant defense mechanisms, so that every barrier surface has its own unique set of immune defenses designed for that location. Priority setting, full frontal innate immunity. Put simply, the cells and molecules of the immune system comprise two parts, innate and adaptive, which we will come to soon. Together, they are your body's safeguard. Innate response is what you notice when you first get sick. Inflammation, for example. It attacks with a vigorous, feet-first approach. What our innate immune response lacks in specificity, it makes up for in speed. The starting lineup features the innate cells, Like scattered listening posts, these are diverse and everywhere in our body. They act as sensors, hardwired to detect anything out of the ordinary, eating germs and debris, calling for backup. Legions of these innate immune foot soldiers rush to assess a problem, attack it with potent killers to defend and potentially harm our bodies, causing significant collateral damage to our own tissues. Our immune system's beautiful destructive dance, with its characteristic heat, swelling, redness, and pain, looks like the scene of a microscopic multi-car crash. As this happens, you may spot those familiar signs: a stuffy nose, sore throat, tummy ache, fever, fatigue, or headache, and then go on to experience familiar symptoms such as increased mucus, pus, and a cough. Now, while inflammation is a vital immune response and fundamental to our health, it is, by design, only supposed to be an acute, short-term assault. This is because it is as damaging to our own tissues as it is to invaders. Triggered incongruously, it can cause problems long after the initial danger is gone. As we'll explore, inflammation is core to our modern-day health complaints, existing on a continuum, from mild symptoms such as weight gain and fatigue at one end, to heart disease, depression, and autoimmune conditions at the other. The path to resolution. When we are sick, the body needs inflammation. But if this response continues for too long, it becomes counterproductive. The imprecise inflammatory defenses discharged by innate cells can wreak havoc on our delicate tissues and even on entire organs. The immune system needs to reduce the inflammation at some point and has therefore acquired the tools to regulate it. So how does inflammation lessen? Let's explore. Acute inflammation and all its associated chemical weaponry also upregulates many anti-inflammatory mechanisms to temper the fire. Special pro-resolving mediators, signaling molecules, are naturally produced in the body during the process of inflammation, and they, ultimately, close the loop on the whole process. Rather than turning the immune system off and risking infection, resolution works in collaboration with inflammation, letting it do its job before gently inviting back the status quo. Common over-the-counter anti-inflammatories, such as ibuprofen or acetaminophen, paracetamol, block important pro-resolving signals, inhibiting the way our bodies naturally resolve inflammation. This is why they are not recommended as a long-term treatment. Aspirin, on the other hand, does not block but gently attenuates, while also stimulating resolution, which is why it is sometimes recommended at a low dose for certain inflammatory conditions. Resolution of inflammation might not seem like such a big deal, but it's paradigm shifting, with vast potential to aid our modern-day health crisis, controlling chronic inflammatory disorders, and promoting wound healing. We can support the resolution of inflammation in other ways too, which, as you will read, may be our best chance during future health challenges. Slow and specific wins the race. Innate immunity is pretty darned good at quickly detecting and eliminating potentially harmful germs, sensing and repairing damage, and quietly removing old or malfunctioning cells. But although it provides immediate protection against intruders, it is incomplete at best. When stressed to the limit, it has to call on its big brother, adaptive immunity. If innate immunity is an initial shotgun blast at all the bad guys, adaptive immunity is a targeted missile. It's a second-line defense that takes a while to kick in, some 5 to 7 days. Unlike innate immunity, which can involve a veritable horde of white blood cells, adaptive immunity is controlled by the lymphocytes. There are two categories of lymphocytes, known as B lymphocytes and T lymphocytes. T lymphocytes are the master controllers, sent out into the body, controlling the levers of many other arms of immunity. B lymphocytes are our special reconnaissance unit, the antibody producers. Each of us has a unique repertoire of T and B lymphocytes, adding a layer of individual exclusivity to our immunity and, consequently, our health. An immune system that doesn't produce a huge variety of unique T and B lymphocytes will probably miss or not see certain germs or viruses, and these could go on, unchallenged, to cause disease. This happens during aging, for example, as we will explore in the next chapter. Adaptive immunity is a remarkably effective process, but much like the innate inflammation response, when it is improperly triggered, it's equally bad for our health. Blurring the lines. To fight off infection and disease, the innate and adaptive parts of our immune system collaborate to detect and destroy anything recognized as foreign or dangerous in the body. We first need to co-opt the innate immune system to capture germs and present them via some oh-so-important compatibility molecules, more on these in a bit, to T lymphocytes waiting in anticipation. The innate immune system is an ingenious doorbell that awakens the adaptive immune response with germs in a format they can recognize. T lymphocytes then swing into action, cloning themselves into huge armies to maximize their fighting power and differentiate into specialized subsets, driving, fine-tuning, and sometimes regulating other immune cells to maximize the chance that intruders are eliminated at minimal cost. Lymph nodes bring B and T lymphocytes together with innate cells at the right place and time. This is why your lymph nodes become swollen when you have a cold coming on. Collectively, the immune system is, in fact, a model of versatility rather than rigid divisions. Feel those swollen lymph nodes next time you have a sore throat and congratulate yourself on successfully linking the innate and adaptive immune systems. How is your memory? Innate immunity is vital for life, but it only has a short-term memory. So instead of mounting a faster and more effective response upon encountering a known trespasser, it starts sluggishly from scratch each time. The adaptive immune system, however, is like a library of memory cells. Information on every virus, bacterium, or fungus that ever invaded your body and was defeated by your immunity is archived by this immune system, identifying them by their molecular shape. This is called immunological memory, and it almost never forgets. Memory cells do not actively fight the current infection. They patrol the body in case of future infection with the same germ, so when we face that same disease-causing germ, this retained memory means we know how to defeat it, often even before we've experienced any symptoms. This explains why you only catch certain diseases once, such as, in most cases, chickenpox, despite repeated exposure. More cunning viruses, however, like influenza and rhinovirus, the cause of the common cold, have developed sneaky ways to evade our immunological memory by continually changing their molecular information. Natural-born killers. Natural killer, NK, cells are, as their name suggests, killing machines. Unlike T and B cells, these are not produced in response to a specific antigen, toxin. Instead, they recognize changes in our own cells. These cells are crucial to our health, rapidly responding to kill our own cells when they get infected with a virus. NK cells are our body's main cancer surveillance tool. With specialized receptors, they patrol the body, inspecting each cell. They respond to newly formed tumors and abnormal growth of our own cells. And they also decide the fate of a pregnancy. NK cells represent 10% of white blood cells, but are also found dotted around the body in various places, including the liver, lungs, and lymph nodes, like your very own Special Forces regiment, with a special number of troops, but just as deadly as an entire infantry division. Really tolerant T cells. Military metaphors can be a useful way to describe our immune defences, but only when we use them in a nuanced way. The immune system is more sophisticated than a ruthless defender using brute force. It is, perhaps, more of a peacekeeping force, seeking a steady, harmonious state, not a constant battleground. Although it focuses on casting out the bad guys, it must do this while causing as little damage as possible. This is to avoid damaging our precious tissues. So who guards the guards? At the top of the peacekeeping chain are T regulatory cells, known as Tregs. Tregs control or suppress other cells in the immune system, fighting substantial fires and making sure the other cells toe the line. Tregs are designed to send a signal that immunity should withdraw, pause an attack, and stand down. Without these regulatory cells and molecules, the state of inflammation that helps destroy threats would lay waste to our bodies. Tregs are crucial to the overall balance of our immunity. They maintain tolerance to good germs, prevent autoimmune diseases, and limit inflammatory ones. But they can also suppress the immune system, preventing it from doing its job against certain infections and tumours. For optimal health, we require sufficient but not excessive regulation by Tregs. Imagine a small proportion of your immune system reserved for regulation. Some of that is genetically determined, but some can be shaped by life choices like diet and exercise, stress and sleep. The system therefore operates on a constant tightrope. Insufficient immunity, too many Tregs, may increase incidence of infections and cancer, while excessive friendly fire, too few Tregs, may lead to damage to our own cells and organs. Vaccination, the great teacher of community immunity. Vaccination is one of public health's greatest success stories, yet it also has become one of the most contentious areas of health policy over the past two decades, and few things are more divisive in immunity than vaccinations. See Chapter 2 for more on this. Vaccines work on the same principle as acquiring an infection naturally. When you acquire an infection naturally, your adaptive immunity, T cells, B cells, and antibodies, are primed to fight off the germ. Then, a residual immunological memory remains, patrolling your body for decades, perhaps even a lifetime, ready to protect you if that germ ever tries to infect again. Your immune system reacts to the vaccine in a similar way to being invaded by the disease itself, introducing a bit of weakened virus or bacteria teaches the immune system how to deal with it. It generates a memory response, so when the real germ comes along, an army is at the ready. Just as each germ is unique, each vaccine is too. The memory produced by vaccines is different for each type. This is why some require booster shots, because vaccines don't totally replicate the natural course of an infection. They, mostly depending on the vaccine, don't all provide the same degree of immunological memory. Why do some people never seem to get sick? In my job, I like to practice what I preach. Most of the time, I have my health pretty much nailed down, but each year, I still catch the odd cold or bug. The average adult will get 2 to 4 colds a year, but some lucky people claim never to catch a cold or take a day off sick. We've all met them, whether it's through family or at work. They breeze through cold and flu season without so much as a sniffle. What is their secret? How can we be more like them? Your immunity is unique to you and determined by several factors. Genetics plays a part, but not in the way you might think. We each have around 25,000 genes, but your genetic code only differs from that of the person next to you by about 1%. You might think that the majority of these differences are related to why we all look different, varying our hair colour, height, or personality. But aside from our brains, the genes that vary most between us are, in fact, a tiny cluster that plays a disproportionately large part in our health. This gene cluster is called the human leukocyte antigen, HLA, also known as the major histocompatibility complex, MHC. Let's call these genes the compatibility genes for short. Our compatibility genes encode our immunity, yet they are as changeable as the pathogens, bacteria or viruses, they aim to prevent. These molecules have evolved to come in a variety of shapes and sizes. They mutate with each generation, unlike any other genes in our bodies, in an effort to track the ever-changing infectious threats we face. Our immunity depends on their combined performance. Our compatibility genes flag viruses and bacteria and present them to the immune system for eradication. The fact that they come in a range of shapes and sizes prevents a virus or bacterium from mutating and then evading the immune system in every person they infect. These special genes tell us a lot about the intricate balancing act essential for not only our health, but the survival of our species. Humans are incredibly similar, but also fundamentally diverse, and compatibility genes are the key to our individuality. Simply put, if all our immune defense systems were identical, a single deadly disease could come along and wipe us all out. But this ingenious process comes with certain trade-offs. For example, we can't easily exchange our body parts. If you have ever received an organ transplant, you will be familiar with the lifelong challenges involved in stopping your body from rejecting the new tissue. In fact, immunity that works wonders for protecting one person can be quite deadly in the life of another. Compatibility genes are the reason why we all fare differently when faced with the same infection. You may have inherited a set of compatibility genes that are expert at dealing with one particular virus, the common cold, say. This does not mean that your immune system is better or worse than mine, just that yours would deal better with fighting this seasonal bug. But when it comes to a different type of germ, I may fare better. And it's not just our individual susceptibility to infection that is affected by our own unique combination of compatibility genes. For example, there are genetic variants in immune compatibility genes that protect some people from the HIV virus, but leave them with an 80% chance of getting a horrible autoimmune disease called ankylosing spondylitis. Like our fingerprints, immunity makes us truly individual. The inherent diversity in how our immune systems respond to different diseases is an entirely deliberate design by Mother Nature without hierarchy. While the world is busy arguing over the physical, visible differences between people, our immune compatibility genes don't discriminate. No one has a better or worse set. It's the collective diversity that's crucial. This diversity has been carefully crafted by evolution. Millions of years of evolution have more or less tuned our immune system to be running optimally. We might not be able to become completely resistant to disease, but it's why we haven't all been wiped out already. Our immunity has been in place for around 500 million years. Its history goes so far back that we share it with other jawed vertebrates. And it has remained largely the same ever since it first evolved. Our immunity is millennia old, shaped and polished by evolution, and, by virtue of this, is very good at what it does. The fact that our immune system is largely untouched by evolution is a testament to how important and effective it is and always has been. Evolution is not a predetermined design process. Rather, it is one that advances in fits of trial and error, as well as chance and necessity. Your successes will carry in them not only the final product of these efforts, a one and only perfect immune system, but also the marks and remnants of many immune systems. If the immune system protects us, why do we still get sick? Most of the time, our bodies win the fight against germs, but sometimes they lose. People who never get sick may catch a slight cold now and again or suffer an occasional ache and pain. This makes sense when you realize that we live in a microbial world and the microbes were here first. Microbes haven't only threatened our health, they have shaped it. They were the first traces of life to appear, and much later on, from within those early microbial ecosystems, and never separate from them, larger multicellular organisms evolved, including us, and we have never quite separated from them. Now we know that there are up to 1 trillion microbial species on Earth, and only a minute fraction of them cause disease. So vilifying all microbes for the sake of a few is a mistake, and possibly one of our biggest. You'll discover why in Chapter 3. Nevertheless, much of the fear of microbes lingers in the public consciousness. As I mentioned, it's quite normal to get up to 4 minor infections, like a cold, each year. But as infections are beaten back by modern-day sanitation, vaccination, and antibiotics, we now have huge increases in non-infectious lifestyle-related diseases. This is no coincidence. Let's look at how infection spreads. Take rhinovirus, the cause of the common cold, for instance. Roughly 1 in 5 people carries the rhinovirus at any given time in the tissues of their nasal passages. The prefix rhine, in Greek, literally means the nose. To infect you, these germs need 3 things. A way to get out of the reservoir, the person sitting near you who is sick. A mode of transportation to a new home, that person sneezing. A sneeze produces 40,000 droplets, and you can get infected by inhaling just one. A way to get into their new home, you. Another classic route for the spread of germs is poor hygiene, especially inadequate hand washing. Bacteria are passed to everything we touch, but simply being a thorough hand washer with good personal hygiene helps you stay healthy and avoid illness-causing bacteria. And while we can't account for how infected people behave around us, we can't control for the immunity genes that we have inherited, we do have some control over the various lifestyle levers we can pull to get the best out of our defences. Nature versus nurture. Like fingerprints, immune systems vary from person to person. We all inherit a unique set of immunity genes, but this is just an instruction manual, and while the code can't be changed, it can be interpreted in many ways. You can help train and maintain it. Epigenetics, the study of how our genetic code is interpreted, is manipulated by many lifestyle factors. An example of epigenetics might be the changes in something called DNA methylation. Essentially, methylation is like handcuffs for a gene, marking that gene as not to be used. If certain genes are methylated, then a cell might not be able to turn on critical functions and could become a cancer cell, for instance. Various environmental factors can alter our methylation pattern, such as smoking, poor diet, air pollutants, and alcohol. Adjustments in our epigenetic patterning can derail some of our vital immune responses. The metaphor used by scientists is, your genes load the gun, but environment pulls the trigger. Just a little immunity TLC from time to time can, for most people, keep all components functioning more smoothly. Despite the prominent role played by genetics, immunity is not fixed by our genes. It's continuously nurtured by our encounters and adventures, shaped by our changing emotions and surroundings, responding to how we live our lives. As mentioned, our immunity even has the capacity to learn and develop a memory. Collectively, this plethora of influences accrued across a lifetime determines, at any given point, if we get sick and for how long. This human exposome is our immunobiography. More on that later. The culmination of everything that challenges our health throughout our lives, including infections, our diets, lifestyle factors, and social influences. In short, it's what we refer to as nurture, nature being the genetic part. This holistic view of health and disease goes some way to explain why some people end up being more susceptible to getting sick. Infection, the facts and the fiction. It starts with a sniffle. Next thing you know, the whole household is sneezing, coughing, and passing tissues. Before long, the common cold, or worse, the seasonal flu, is upon you all. Wondering how you can dodge those germs or boost your immunity? With so much conflicting advice out there, it can be difficult to know what to believe. So let's start by putting myths to rest with a simple guide. Number one tip to avoid infection. In the mid-19th century, Ignaz Semmelweis, a Hungarian doctor, made an important discovery. He linked childbed fever among women who had just delivered their babies in the hospital to the failure of the doctors who delivered those babies to wash their hands after performing anatomical dissections of the dead. The key to reducing infection was simple: wash your hands. Semmelweis died before his theory gained support, but hand washing remains a cornerstone of modern day infection control. Most people are infectious before they get symptoms. Before the onset of symptoms, a person may already have an infection. How this works depends on the germ in question. Respiratory viruses are best engineered to spread when you have physical symptoms. The more symptomatic you are, the more you sneeze and cough, the more likely you are to spread an infection. But sometimes you can infect others with a virus even when you are asymptomatic. For influenza, you are infectious one day before symptoms and 5 to 7 days after their onset. Young children and patients with altered immune systems can spread the virus for longer periods of time. It's just a mild cold. Am I less infectious? Just because you have mild symptoms doesn't mean the virus is mild. It may just mean that you lucked out with your compatibility genes for that particular germ and your immune system is able to control the infection. For this reason, it's important to remember that even with minimal symptoms, you can still infect others and potentially make some people really sick, especially those who are vulnerable, including the elderly and very young. Why do colds and flu strike in winter? Seasonal influenza, flu, viruses are detected all year round in the United States, but they are more common in the fall. The season generally reaches its peak in winter and can continue as late as May. In the UK, the flu season starts in October and is in full swing by December, generally reaching its peak in February and ending in March. For our Antipodean cousins, the season is flipped. Put simply, whenever and wherever there is winter, there is flu. Even the word influenza may be a clue. Its original Italian name, influenza di freddo, means influence of the cold. A common misconception, however, is that flu is caused by cold temperatures. This is not quite true. Flu is caused by the influenza virus. Cold temperatures simply create conditions that make it easier for the virus to spread. Scientists now know that the influenza virus is transmitted best at cooler temperatures and low humidity. So the viruses that cause the flu survive better in winter and are able to infect more people. Another reason is the lack of sunlight and the different lifestyles we lead in winter months. Days are colder and shorter during the winter, so we spend more time indoors and are more likely to share air with someone who's infected. Lack of sunlight leads to low levels of vitamin D, a key immune-nourishing nutrient. Having less vitamin D decreases our immunity's ability to fight the virus. You'll catch a cold from being cold. Put on a jacket or you'll catch a cold. I'm sure you were told this as a child, but nowadays it is usually dismissed as an age-old misconception. Much like the previous point, it's the virus, not the temperature, that makes us sick, right? Well, yes, but it turns out that this advice contains a kernel of truth, too. It has been shown that when you are exposed to the cold for a prolonged time, you may not be able to launch the most robust immune attack. While this effect might be marginal in most healthy people, older people, young kids, or those with underlying health issues may have an even harder time fighting off the virus. So, it's best to heed your parents' advice and bundle up when heading out in the cold. Wearing a scarf in winter does warm the air in the back of your throat, making it less hospitable for those seasonal viruses that prefer cool air. Disease symptoms are sometimes the immune system doing its job. You might have heard that bacteria, viruses, and fungi are the cause of disease symptoms, but often this is technically incorrect. Disease symptoms mostly occur because your immune system is at work reacting to trespassing microorganisms with inflammation. Take the example of the common cold. Your immune system jumps into action when the cold virus, rhinovirus, invades the epithelial cells that line your airways. Immune system chemicals dilate your blood vessels and increase their permeability, allowing proteins and white blood cells to reach the infected tissues in your nose, sinuses, and throat. However, this causes nasal congestion. Additionally, you may get a runny nose because of the increased fluid leakage from your permeable capillaries, combined with increased mucus production triggered by the immune response itself. Then there is fever. Through evolution, we developed fever as a response to infection. Raising your temperature makes most germs less efficient at multiplying and helps your immune cells work more effectively. There is evidence that fever even improves the ability of antibiotics to kill bacteria. Awareness of this phenomenon has given rise to two appealing but conflicting schools of thought. One theory is that fever is a natural part of the immune response to infection, so we shouldn't interfere with it. The other is that fever is a potentially harmful consequence of infection, so we should suppress it to minimize any complications. What does science have to say about these conflicting theories? There is actually little evidence that fever itself, even a high one, is harmful. Unless you are really uncomfortable, have difficulty breathing, or have a fever lasting more than a few days, it's normally wise to avoid fever-reducing medications like acetaminophen or ibuprofen, as they are not without side effects. The immune system can still get its job done if you take medicine to reduce fever, but slightly less effectively, and taking it won't speed up the process. Over-the-counter. No one wants to stay at home feeling miserable with a cold or the flu, and sometimes you just can't. So what about all those over-the-counter, OTC, cold and flu medications? Most OTC cough syrups are not effective for adults or children, and the CDC now recommends honey rather than cough syrup. OTC cold and flu medications won't cure or even shorten your cold or flu, but there is some evidence that they may provide some symptom relief in adults. Each time my husband catches a cold, he treks to the pharmacy, spending, wasting, lots of money searching for a cure. Perhaps the idea that he is proactively looking after himself makes him feel better about the situation, which may create a little placebo effect. But the pills he buys won't cure his cold. Reducing symptoms is, however, often desirable or necessary if life demands that you function. So if work really can't wait, which product is best for your symptoms? Here's the lowdown. Antibiotics definitely don't help and shouldn't be used for the viruses that cause colds and flu. Cold and flu tablets may contain decongestants, pain relievers, antihistamines, and cough suppressants. So think carefully about your main symptoms when selecting a product and read the label carefully. Avoiding taking medicine you don't need reduces the risk of side effects. Decongestant tablets can have effects beyond the nose and may exacerbate other medical conditions such as high blood pressure. Speak to your pharmacist before taking these medicines. When it comes to immunity, there are few quick fixes. The minor benefits from certain treatments need to be weighed against the risk of side effects.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.